Now we are going to try and look at what are the various ways in which we can ensure that this kind of equivalence can be established. A lot of our internal validity of the experiment actually depends upon how well we do this. So let us look at some of the experimental modes that we use to ensure that the two groups are actually matched or actually equivalent to begin with. One of the modes that is typically used and what is the gold standard of a true experimental design is the mode called randomization. This is actually quite a difficult mode to achieve, and so one should not loosely use the word that, you know, a randomized experiment was done. What exactly is required here? What we need to do is take a pool of subjects and randomly assign these subjects to the experimental group and to the control group to ensure that we are not biased towards any particular group. Let us take an example. Suppose I take a classroom and I'm trying to compare two different learning techniques or learning methods, and I take all the bright students, the high achievers in the classroom, and allot them to one particular experimental group. And then if I take the relatively low achievers and put them into the control group and then run my experiment, I'm almost sort of planning beforehand what my results are going to be like. It's going to be a very, very biased finding, because my subjects were not equivalent to begin with. So what I would need to do is to take the roll call and randomly assign one and one to each experimental and control group to ensure that they were actually equivalent to begin with. And that sometimes even requires random number tables in order to achieve proper randomization. So randomization is one excellent mode that we can use in experimental designs. Sometimes it becomes difficult to take one subject at a time and manage this kind of randomization. In such instances, one can use what are called randomized block designs or randomized group designs, where I can take an entire block of subjects at one shot and put it into one condition and take the other block and put it into the other condition. For example, if I have a division of students, division A and division B. Once again, one must be very clear that these divisions were not in the first place based on any kind of ability or any kind of mode of selection, because then you have your bias creeping into your experiment right from the start. Another mode that is often used, again, it is quite difficult to achieve, but many experiments do it, is called the matching mode. In this, what you do is you try to pick up the relevant variables. They may be gender, they may be age, they may be the amount of education the person has had, and so on. And we try to allot one of each of this matched pair to each of the experimental and the control conditions respectively. So let us say I have in my total experimental design, in my total subject pool, I have say two females, both of whom are aged 23. I'm going to place one of them in my E group and one of them in my C group, so that later, if there are going to be any kind of vitiating effects of age or gender, then I have balanced them out across the two groups. So matching is indeed a very good measure, very good way in which I can ensure that my groups are really equivalent to start with. Another interesting and a very useful way of using this kind of methodology to ensure internal validity is what is called measurement. Wherever I come across a variable which I think might in some way interfere with my experiment, I measure it. So what I have is a score or some kind of a measurement on a scale which I can then feed into my statistical analysis, and if required, I can partial that out of the entire procedure. So I can be very confident in the end because I have measured whatever other intrusive variables are likely to affect my experiment, and I know that because I have measured them, I have a quantity and I can therefore deal with this particular score and try and remove it from the impact of the entire experiment. I am now going to talk to you about some of the very important roles, very important jobs that an experimenter must carry out if the experiment has to be successful. The experimenter has to be very particular about all these procedures that I've just talked to you about. When it comes to sampling, when it comes to ruling out bias of any sort from the various groups that come into the experimental and the control group. Also, the experimenter has to look at what will be the impact if the subjects know they are part of that particular experiment. For this, what the experimenter needs to do is to institute a single blind, which means that the subjects are not aware which group they are in. So if I am a student in that classroom or if I am a participant in that medical experiment, I do not know whether I am going to be part of the experimental group or control group, and so I have no expectations from myself. I do not have any kind of bias in terms of what kind of performance I am likely to deliver on the task which is given to me to actually measure the DV. And so, if the experimenter is successfully be able to establish a single blind, then all the subjects in the pool are completely unaware whether they are E subjects or C subjects, experimental subjects or control subjects. But then you also have the factor of what happens if the experimenter is aware of which subjects are exactly in which group. Because if I know that this is an experimental subject, I might have a very high expectation of performance from them, and I might actually very subtly and unknowingly encourage them to give me a better performance, so I may pay more attention to them and so on. In order to achieve this, the experimenter has to institute what is called a double blind. Therefore, not only has he ensured that the subjects are not aware which particular group they belong to, but also the experimenter is not aware which particular group is being handled at a particular time. A very simple way to do this in the medical example I cited would be to not put the value, not put the mg, 5 mg, 10 mg, 15 mg labels on the vials. So what the doctor who is going to actually administer these medications would see on the vials is some kind of a code like A, B, C. And so they have no idea which particular potency they are actually giving to the subjects during the experiment. It is only later, after the time of analysis, when the code is being cracked open, that the experimenter would know which exactly were the subjects in all the different levels of the experiment. So single blinds and double blinds are extremely important in experimental procedures. Another important thing which we must pay attention to is the concept of replication. An experimenter should be able to confidently say that if the same experiment is once again carried out under similar conditions, the kind of results that are produced would actually be the same or similar. This is a sure way to ensure that when other researchers undertake a similar experiment, they are satisfied with regard to how well, how accurately it was conducted in the first place. So replication is a very, very important part of science, and we always have high replicability in well-designed experiments. We are now going to look at some factors which will actually interfere with our test findings, with our experimental findings. So here again, the experimenter or the researcher has to be very, very careful that these factors are not creeping into his experimental design. These are very well-known factors. They have been well-established, well-researched, but I'm just going to list them for you at this particular time, although I'm sure many of you are already aware of these factors. One important factor is the factor of history. What sort of other events have been exposed to this subject, or what sort of other events has the subject been exposed to in the course of this experiment? Has anything happened around the subject which will actually affect them in such a way that their performance on the dependent variable may actually change? So history has to be an important factor that one has to pay attention to. Another factor is maturation. One must remember that as the experiment proceeds, time is passing. And there are changes that are happening in the subject himself or herself. Has this maturation factor played a role in actually changing the kind of DV scores that are delivered by the subject? That is something that the experimenter must look at very carefully. So history and maturation are two factors which might interfere with the accuracy of your experimental findings, and one must take care that these are controlled for. Another factor to look at is the testing procedure itself. You see, sometimes what can happen is subjects can become test wise, or the testing procedure itself may interfere with the kind of performance they give on a task. So one has to take great care that the testing itself has not interfered in some way. We are all aware that subject attrition can happen. Along the way, certain subjects might actually drop out of an experiment. We also, of course, follow ethical guidelines, and so we always give consent. We allow the subject to give consent to be part of this experiment. So if the subject at any point wishes to leave the experiment, we have to always ethically allow the subject to do so. And therefore, mortality or dropping out of the subjects out of the experiment is a big factor to look at. Is there any selectivity in this mortality? Is there a specific factor which is causing certain subjects to leave, for example, certain temperamental traits like impatience or maybe a lower ability which doesn't allow them to carry out the task fast enough? Or is one set of subjects very busy and so they don't want to give more time? So in other words, has there been any selection factor which has actually led to this very selective mortality or selective attrition of these subjects? This is a factor also that one must look at. Another important factor is the factor of instrumentation. You see, along the way, as you are using certain dials or certain hardware, or even if you are using Likert type questionnaires, scales and so on, certain changes might actually come about in the instrument. Maybe the way you give your instructions might begin to change because you're bored giving the same long instructions over and over again, or your actual instrument panels might go through some kind of change, and that will really affect the internal validity of your experiment. So instrumentation, whatever tool it is that you are using, must be regularly checked in order to ensure that the same kind of results that were being delivered by that instrumentation at the beginning of the experiment are actually continuously being delivered throughout the experimental procedure, and there is no real change that is happening in this. Another very interesting thing can happen. There is this phenomenon which is called statistical regression. What happens in this? If you repeatedly go on taking measures from a particular group of subjects, there is a very high chance that these scores start drawing towards the mean. This is called a statistical regression towards the mean. So you see what will keep happening? As you repeatedly collect more and more scores from the subjects, they will all start appearing to be closer and closer to the central tendency of the entire set of scores. And this definitely is going to affect the measures, it's going to affect the data that are going to emerge from this experiment. So one has to take care of statistical regression by ensuring that not too many repetitions of measures are actually being taken. Let us look at a couple of more factors. You will say, oh, there are so many difficulties, so many hurdles that an experimenter has to face. But yes, it is very important to be a good scientist to know exactly where these hurdles lie, to know exactly where the flaws can come in your experiment. So here is a flaw that we have actually talked about, but I'm going to repeat it because it's extremely important, and this is called selection. Has there been any subtle process because of which I have, as an experimenter, selected certain subjects to be part of my E group and certain subjects to be part of my C group? Have I unknowingly actually created a barrier where the E group is already stronger than the C group, and in some way, therefore, my results are predictable that the E group is going to do better? So remember what we said earlier about randomization. One must ensure that there is no selection effect that has come about in any kind of experiment of ours. Sometimes one takes a great deal of care in dividing up the two conditions, calling it the experimental group and the control group. Let's take a simple example. Suppose I am teaching a classroom and I am using a specific method, like maybe field trips or showing the students some kind of films or showing them some kind of websites, giving them links to read from, and I am thinking that this kind of an enriched environment is actually going to help them learn better. And in my control group, I might use a standard lecture method like a chalk and talk technique that one typically uses in the classroom, right? Again, let us take another medical example because we have been going with these examples from before. So let us say we're giving one particular group not only the other conditions that we have, which are counterbalanced or matched in both conditions, but we're giving them this very highly nutritive snack, which we think is very good for them. and the control group is not being given this particular snack. So you think you're being very careful and distinguishing between the experimental and control group. Now what might happen is what is called a diffusion of treatments. What does this mean, diffusion of treatments? It means that there is a kind of leakage, that the control group becomes aware of what sort of treatment is being given to the experimental group, and they get a little sensitized and they too start doing those things, thinking, why should we not do them? So imagine a situation in the educational example that I used, where the control group starts going to the same links, looking at the same videos, checking out the same slide sets or other movies or other learning material which was given to them. Very soon, there will really be no difference between the ENC groups, and this is not your doing. This has happened because of diffusion of treatments. Similarly, in the medical experiment, suppose the experimental group has been having this nutritious snack and the control group becomes aware of it and says, oh, they are eating such nutritious food, I also must do something like that. And so unwittingly and unknown to the experimenter, what if this kind of diffusion of treatment happens? So one has to be very careful that whatever partitions one has created actually have remained to the end of one's experiment. Sometimes one comes across another very interesting effect, which in some literature has been called a John Henry effect. I'll explain to you what that is. You see, what can happen, and this happened with this gentleman called John Henry, which is why it's given this name, that subjects in the control group start feeling very motivated to do well for some reason. And so subjects in the control group, although they are really not being given the experimental treatment, begin to try very hard to perform well. And so actually what starts happening is your data starts looking very similar. There is really not much gap between the experimental and the control group performance. And you wonder why, till you start realizing that it's the control group subjects that have become very motivated and are trying very hard. So you see, these are the subtle little difficulties that can come up in the course of experimentation, and one must take great care to ensure that they don't really come in and vitiate and interfere with our experiment.